Good morning again. Unfortunately, I got this new thing where I'm like something is catching in my hip. It's great. I can't wait to get it fixed, though. I'll tell you that much. Well, I had to stop there to get him because I was like, I can't like stand up straight. But whatever it is, it works itself out. I can get it out of there. So sorry, I apologize. Feel my pain. Yeah, right. So we're back on regular schedule here. We're in this series of Philippians and discussing what made them different, what made them stand out. And we're looking at Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 11. And this is probably the most famous section of Scripture in the book of Philippians. If you've ever read the book of Philippians, this is the section that most people refer to. In my Bible, it's underlined completely, the first 11 verses. So I'm an underliner, so I underline a lot. But it's about Christ's humility. And we're going to discuss that and how that relates to us and how it should move us to live more like Jesus. And so as we look at this, we're gonna see what Jesus does for us. But let me get started, let me pray, and then we'll jump in. God, I just come to you to thank you so much for this day. And again, thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to teach. Lord, thank you for this chapter that you wrote through Paul. It's an amazing section, Lord, and I pray that you'd help us to really hone in on it and glean things from it, and how we might live our lives in humility as well, Lord. Help us to live for you in all that we do, no matter what. Lord, move me out of the way. Use me as an instrument to communicate your word, that's all. And speak to all of our hearts and our minds this day through your words. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. In the summer of 1986, two ships collided in the Black Sea off the coast of Russia. Hundreds of passengers died as they were hurled into the icy waters below. News of the disaster was further darkened when an investigation revealed the cause of the accident. It wasn't a technology problem like radar malfunction or wasn't even natural disaster like a thick fog. The cause was human stubbornness. Each captain was aware of the other ship's presence nearby. Both could have steered clear, but according to the news reports, neither captain wanted to give way to the other. Each one was too proud to yield. By the time they came to their senses, it was too late. As we look at this section of Scripture, in the sermon number 4 of studying this letter, this passage today is actually contingent on what we've talked about before. About how we live our lives and how we conduct ourselves in the manner that is worthy of the gospel. How it is in a manner that Jesus would have us conduct ourselves. Remember, a couple weeks ago we talked about how our conduct matters as Christians. It matters because it not only shows us who we are, but it testifies to the world around us. It matters because it verifies what the Holy Spirit is doing in us. And it matters because our conduct creates unity in the church. And unity among the church is one of the strongest things we have as believers. And when we conduct ourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel, it means so much. And we're going to look at this idea that Christ lived his life in a way that was humble. And we look at this and we wonder, well, okay, this is kind of a pivotal moment. It was like, why if the Philippians church was so perfect and they were conducting themselves that was good in a manner worthy of the gospel, so why does Paul then need to explain it? Well, that's just the very reason. Maybe because they were doing everything right. They thought they were better than everyone else amongst the churches and the community at large. That can happen sometimes in our lives and in our community life here. Maybe perhaps some within this church were doing more than others, and they were going, hey, loser, do more, right? Maybe they were saying things that were not creating unity amongst the body. They weren't being humble. You know, we know that the gospel was spreading, good works were being done, but were they using it as a status symbol among the church? Look at me, I'm better than you. Right? These are all possibilities that could have happened. We don't know because he doesn't really address it. But these are things that have happened in my life and in church life. In my years I've been in church, I've seen all of these things. And as humans, I think it reoccurs. And when we discuss humility, humility is one of those things that can be a very hard thing to swallow. Think of like those giant horse pill antibiotics that you got to swallow. Okay? That's kind of like what humility is in my life sometimes. Okay? Because why? Because my pride and my selfishness get in the way. And honestly, I believe that pride and selfishness are the root of a lot of the problems we face as people, as humans, as Christians, and as the church. And God here, through Paul, says, look, there's a higher example. The highest example possible is to be humble like Jesus. Because if the Son of God can embrace humility, guess what? So can we. So if your Bible's there, let's read it. Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 11. Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourself. Each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus. And here's where Paul outlines what the humility of Jesus is. Who, being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant. Being made in human likeness, and being found in the appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. What an exciting passage this is. We have this therefore statement again. Remember, we talked about how that is contingent upon what is said before. And I've told you many, many times that when you see the word therefore in Scripture, you have to find out what it's there for. So that means you have to go back and read what they're referring to in order to keep it in context. He says, therefore, if you have any encouragement for being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion. It's almost like it's not if, it's since you're doing these things. Because that's what Christ wants you to do. If you're doing them, since you're doing them, these things should be true about you. We have this appeal on the basis of that which we have the Holy Spirit that comes in us, and this is what we should be doing. They've been united with Christ in his death through baptism. And now they've been raised to a new life. And this love should be a result of the spiritual unity. And I'll tell you what, one of the Holy Spirit's ministries is that in all of our lives, is to produce concern for others in the church. When someone's not here, or when someone's sick, or someone's been gone a while, our hearts shouldn't just go, well, oh, they're doing okay. Our hearts should go, I wonder what's going on, or how can I reach out to them, or how can, okay? It's meant to be a motivation. You see, it's meant to encourage us, to build us up. And because Paul goes on to say, he says, then make my joy complete, right? Make my joy complete. It means that it's a whole thing. You see, we can experience that same wholeness when we are working like Paul, while God wants us to work. He shares through Paul, the Apostle Paul. And the goal of this entire section is that we would find unity through humility. Let me say that again. The goal is to find unity, togetherness, wholeness, through humility. that we put others first in all matters of life instead of putting someone on a lower pedestal because they don't produce as many Christians as Joe over there. We look at him and we go, yeah, he's not doing much. Right? Because Paul references it. He makes a shift. He says there, you know, he talks about how the wholeness of the church and the unity here, and then he says, okay, in verse 3, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Right? But in what? In humility. Put others above yourself. Not looking at your own interest, but the interest of others. What we have to understand here is the terminology that he's using here. This is the same terminology that he's using from Philippians 1:17 when he's talking about those people that are preaching out of selfish ambition as well. It's the same principle that they're taking advantage of the fact that he was in prison, and it's the same thing here when he uses this word selfish ambition here. It's the same thing. They're taking advantage of a person's lower position. And Paul's telling them, he says, you can't do this. It doesn't work like this in the church. You cannot be working like this in order to create that wholeness that we're talking about. And God, through Paul, is telling all of the church, not just then, but now, this isn't supposed to happen amongst Christians. We aren't supposed to operate this way. And if you're elevating yourself on a pedestal to a place that you say, hey, I'm better than Sally over there because I give more, I do more, I serve more, then you're missing the point. We aren't supposed to achieve things by trying to outdo others. Let me say that again. We are not supposed to achieve things by trying to outdo others. What we do is maintain the truth, and we glorify God through our actions. We preach the word wherever we go. We spread the gospel among the masses. And what does it matter if that, the church over there that is preaching the gospel is experiencing growth, or that Johnny has all the people coming to him in order to tell them about Jesus? This is something that is so often violated amongst the community of believers, especially in bigger cities where multiple Christian churches are. Most of you have heard of this church in Louisville, Kentucky called Southeast Christian Church. How many of you have heard of that church? It's a big church. It's like 23,000 people now. It might be more. They experienced massive growth. Back in the 90s, they experienced massive growth. And they changed some of the things that they were doing, and they were in front of kind of the programming issues and the small group and things, and people loved it, and they were building community and unity, but what they were creating was they were also creating a mess for other churches, because people were leaving churches and going over there. It's like, why aren't we doing this? And people were getting mad because they were getting all the attention and all the press. Churches in the area were being outdone by them. However, what Southeast did was actually set the example, and eventually other churches began to change, began to feel more like home and create unity amongst their believers and have people experience this growth that they didn't know that they had. And because the people were growing, the church began to grow around them. And I don't know if any of you have ever been to Louisville, Kentucky, there are literally churches everywhere. I mean, it's in the Bible Belt, right? But there are churches that are doing great things, and there are big churches. A lot of people go to church in Kentucky. And this is just one example, and this happens all over the place. But how often do Christians try to outdo each other all over the place? We create it like a sports competition, right? I get it. In sports, there should be a competition, right? You should try to outdo each other because you want to win the game, right? But not amongst the believers. It shouldn't be like this. You know, the disciples even argued about who was the greatest disciple, and they walked around with Jesus. It happens more than we think. And I'm not saying it to excuse our behavior. I'm not. I'm not saying, well, the disciples were with Jesus, so it gives us the okay to do it. It doesn't. There is absolutely no holiness found in trying to outdo each other. The idea that it seems to be is someone who has a desire to attract attention to themselves, to honor themselves above God and win praise, to make themselves the object of attention for the purpose of being noticed. Doesn't work like that. If you know a little bit about the Bible, I want to ask you, how'd that work out for Ananias and Sapphira? How about the Sanhedrin? It didn't work out very well for them. You see, when we're looking to call attention to ourselves and lift ourselves above someone else or be the best at it, remember what Jesus said about it? They have received their reward in full. So what is it then? We're called to be humble. We're called to treat each other as we would treat ourselves. And in fact, when we're to treat each other, each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also the interest of others. And we've got to be able to do this, but it starts somewhere. It has to start with our relationship with God. Because humility before God will lead to humility in our relationship with others. We think about some other scriptures in 1 Peter 5, 5 and 6. Peter says this, he says, in the same way, you who are younger, submit yourselves to your elders. All of you clothe yourselves with humility toward one another, because God opposes the proud but shows favor to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Now, I want you to understand this is an address to the elders of the church, but Peter shifts gears. He says, in verse 5, he says, All of you, clothe yourselves with humility. How do we do that? How do we accomplish this in our lives? How do we move forward from this? How do we look to the interest of others? Now, I will tell you, we're not supposed to let our care and attention be completely and solely centered on our own, okay? Remember, we talked last week for Valentine's Day that God already knows that we love ourselves. Okay? He does. It doesn't mean that we don't care for ourselves. It doesn't mean that we don't go out and do whatever we want to ourselves. It doesn't give us the green light to be in everybody's personal business either. So what does it really mean to put ourselves in the interest of others? What does that mean? What does it mean to truly look out for somebody else? And I would say it's the duty of everyone to do this. Every Christian. Nobody is at the liberty to live for themselves. If you've ever spent time in the Bible, you will know that. We are not to just throw up blinders and solely focus on God. Because we know that, again, as an example, Jesus would confront the Pharisees about that, the Sadducees about that, the religious council. And say, look, don't listen to them, because they're saying it, but they're not doing it. We have an obligation to look out for the needs of others. We're to have the same attitude of Christ. Did you catch that? Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus. And we think, well, I can't be like Jesus, right? My goal is to be like him as a Christian, right? But I can never attain that status, right? We struggle. We go through things. We get down in the dumps sometimes, and we need to be lifted up. That's why we're a community. That's why we have unity amongst the body. It's so that way when one of us is down, we lift them up. What does Jesus say about it? I take that back. I don't know if that was Jesus or not. I think it was Paul. You know, when our arm is injured, we don't cut it off, do we? We help it heal. Right? We don't throw it away. And this is what it means to be on the lookout for the interests of others. That we're aware of what's going on around us. We look into people's lives and we see them hurting, or we see them struggling, and we lift them up. Because we have the perfect example of what humility looks like. In verses 6 through 8, we have this perfect example of who Jesus was. And it's meant to reinforce what Christ did. The humility that he showed. And the humility that we as Christians are supposed to have. If Jesus is the highest example of that, and we're called to live like him, we're called to make Jesus our model, then this is the example that it looks like. That Jesus would leave heaven and come here. Let me explain. The importance of this rests on the fact that Jesus is equal with God. Okay? Jesus was divine. His consent to become a human was the most remarkable of all possible acts of humility. You see, he was in the very essence of God. He is God. Decided to put that aside and embrace what it is to be human. He didn't cling to it and he didn't lord it while he was here. And he was willing to set it aside and become like us and make his dwelling amongst us. He surrendered his right. He gave it up willingly. He gave up the splendor and the awe and the awesomeness that is the throne of God. When it says that he made himself nothing, little translation is that he emptied himself of his divinity. It means that he laid aside his rank and his dignity, and in comparison that he would come and become nothing like us. Because in the Old Testament, you couldn't even be in the presence of God. There was a lot of priests that dropped dead back in the day because they were in the presence of God. And if you notice in the Old Testament, there were several times where they realize that they're in the presence of an angel of God or God himself. And what is the first thing they typically do? Fall down on their face and go, "Oh, please don't kill me." Right? Because there's this reverence around God. And Christ emptied himself of that to be like us. He humbled himself. And it even says that he made himself a servant. Oh my gosh, this is one of the greatest things about Jesus that I love, is that a servant is the lowest form of job there was. You literally did everything that was disgusting. Okay? You were nothing in comparison to even somebody a little higher. That was why when Jesus took off his outer cloak and put wrapped a towel around his waist and began to wash the feet of his disciples, the disciples were like, "Whoa, what are you doing, man?" Because that was the lowest of low jobs there was a servant. And a servant washed the nasty, cruddy feet of people that walked in the desert all day long. Sweaty, hot, gross, ew. Right? So Jesus emptied himself and became a servant. Obedient to God's will and his purpose. He obeyed when his obedience resulted even in his death, it says. Can I tell you that it's easy to be cheerfully obedient when there's no danger in your life? It's easy because we don't have a threat of death or hurt. But I'll tell you what, there might come a day where we have to stand and go, "I'm a Christian," in the face of a rifle, in the face of persecution. I pray for the state of America and the church a lot. I find myself doing it more now because I don't want my kids to experience it. But I am confident in our Lord. I am confident in my salvation. And that's exactly what Jesus was. He was confident, but also obedient. He subjected himself to the worst death that there could be. And I'll tell you, it wasn't quick. Crucifixion was literally the perfected torture by the Romans, a perfected torture, if that makes any sense. Crucifixion means excruciating. That's where we get the word excruciating from crucifixion. And we know what the word excruciating means. worst pain possible, right? Crucifixion was lingering, painful, humiliating. It, you know, Jesus wasn't wearing a little loincloth across his crotch, okay? He was naked in front of the whole world. It's humiliating. It was only fit for the worst of criminals, and yet he did nothing. You see, Jesus knew the cost of obedience and humility. That when he came, he knew that was the plan. He was offered to give it up, but he didn't because of us. Because of his humility. So what did God do for him? Exalted him to the highest authority. Like it's written in the last book of the Bible, Revelation, everyone will bow. He was given the keys to death and Hades itself. This is just a little theory of mine, but Satan had some authority to give Jesus when he took him up on the highest place. He said, I'll give you all of it. He had some sort of authority. But the Bible tells us that Jesus says, all authority in heaven and on earth is now mine, has been given to me. You see, Jesus takes this position of authority because of his humility. He came to earth as a man to die for us, to show us the way to heaven through resurrection. And we are called to align ourselves with this, with Jesus, with this humility. And if Jesus can do it, I know it's hard, but if we want to strive and be like him, we're not always going to be perfect. I will tell you that. We will fail at this humility thing. But that's the great thing about God, is he forgives you. He forgives me when I mess up. And humility is part of that, recognizing that we've messed up. We can embrace some form of humility in our lives as well, folks. And can I tell you that humility simply means that letting go. Letting go is not something that is easy because we want to hold on so tight and we want to think that we have some authority and some control. Sometimes being humble like Jesus means to be the bigger person. There might be a dispute in our lives or somewhere, somehow, but it means that we rise to the top. Not because so we can go, ha, I'm better than you, but because we want to be humble like Jesus. To be humble like Jesus means to achieve unity amongst the body of believers. Sometimes there's infighting that happens amongst the believers, and I would encourage you to rise above that and be ready and willing to let those things go. We have to be willing to put others first. We are meant to be the hands and feet of Jesus on earth, and as Christians, we are called to that higher standard. Once we are in Jesus, once we are saved, it shouldn't be about us anymore. Because that's the way the world lives. I know I don't want to do it anymore. At least I shouldn't want to do it anymore. And we have this firmest example of what humility looks like through Jesus. Jesus thought of us when he left his throne. He emptied himself. He thought of us to come down here. Humility, like Jesus, also means to be being obedient to God. You see, Jesus was obedient to God's will. Remember in the garden, not my will, but yours be done. And he knew what that obedience meant. Death and humiliation on the cross. But I'll tell you what, that might not be our road. We might not be called to die on a cross, but we are called to humble ourselves in obedience to what God has for us. How does the Bible put it? Dying to ourselves and living for Jesus. Take up our cross daily. Can I tell you that being obedient is not always easy? And I am no means perfect at it. And I don't intend to minimize the struggles that we all face in life. But at the end of the day, being obedient to Scripture and being obedient to the Holy Spirit, the call of the Holy Spirit in my life, is the ultimate symbol of humility. I'll close with this. There are so many reasons why humility is important as followers of Jesus. Being humble like Jesus means that we have to rise above our selfishness and those grudges, even when it's hard, even when we don't want to. When all we want to do is resist and not let go of what is inside of us. Being humble like Jesus means letting that go. Being humble like Jesus means putting others first, even when we don't think they deserve it. And being humble like Jesus means being obedient to God's word and the calling of the Holy Spirit, wherever that takes us. You know, we sometimes struggle in our lives to talk to people about our relationship with Jesus or even, in fact, sharing the gospel of Jesus with people. It's not always easy. There's resistance at every turn. But my prayer for all of us as we leave here today is that we can embrace this kind of humility in our daily lives, in our relationships, whether they're good or bad, so that we can find unity together here that might bring the gospel of Jesus to the world, to the community around us, and to our homes. I would encourage you that if you're not living in a humble way, look to Jesus. He emptied himself to become like us. He gave up his divinity, his throne, to come and die in our place. Jesus gave it all up. He humbled himself even to death on the cross. Pray with me. God, I just come to you to thank you again. Lord, what an amazing section of Scripture, Lord. It fires me up, but it also makes me look deep within myself, my failures. So, Lord, I pray that you would help all of us as we search our hearts and our minds. Lord, that you would work in us and through us and allow the Holy Spirit, that we would allow the Holy Spirit to work in us and mold us and shape us and help us to grow and to love and to look at other people's interests, not only to our own, but the interest of others. Lord, that we might bring ourselves low. Lord, there's sometimes the fighting happens or hurtful things have been said in our lives. And Lord, I pray that you'd help us to let go of that. And we might seek reconciliation or forgiveness. Lord, I know that we've all experienced it in our families, in our workplaces, in the church. Lord, I pray that you'd help us to be humble. We might humble ourselves because you show us how. Lord, thank you for loving us. Thank you for emptying yourself and coming here, Lord, and being like us. Lord, may we go out from here with humility in our hearts. Help us in our time of need, Lord. It's in Jesus' precious holy name I pray. Amen. Our music team's going to come forward this morning, and we're going to do a closeout song for us. I always offer it to you. If you need to talk to somebody about Jesus, I'm available, or one of our elders are available to talk. You can talk now, or talk after church, whatever it is. But if you don't know who Jesus is fully, I ask that you come talk. I'd love to share Jesus with you. Let's stand and let's sing.
When love floods.
Like to come and help out with that volunteer. We're going to talk about what the games are and where you can fill in at. But other than that, have a great week. Go out and love God, love others, and let me pray. God, I just come to you to thank you so much for this day and thank you for the opportunity, Lord, to be together. Lord, I pray that we would be humble in order to bring unity amongst our family here, to the community at large, and to our homes, and to our workplaces. Lord, help us to always remember to humble ourselves before you, Lord. It's in Jesus' precious holy name I pray. Amen. Have a great week.